Hey guys, thank you for joining us on another episode of Hollywood Ball Podcast. My name is Stefan.
My name is Rin.
And this is another impromptu podcast. We're just gonna let everything flow organically. Whatever's coming up on our mind, we're just gonna say it. So first thing on the agenda, I just wanna ask Rin, so Rin, what's going on today? What have you been doing this week?
Today?
Yeah.
I worked all day. I'm just glad that I'm done with work.
Let's tell the audience what you do. What do you do?
I'm a barbershop owner. I'm a barber. I got a barbershop, and pretty much I have an employee of me, my pops, and sometimes my brother.
Okay. You know, in case they were wondering, what's the name of your barbershop and where are you located?
Cali Prime Barbershop. It's off of Anaheim and Loma. It's 3600 East Anaheim, Suite B.
And just if you guys wonder, we're in Long Beach, California.
It's on the east side.
The east side.
Yeah, I'm also internet entrepreneur. I sell things online. I got my own eBay store. If you want to go check it out, it's online top shelf underscore RSC.
That's the plug, right?
That's the plug.
Rin is the only one that can actually do plug, all right? He's the only one with the exception. If you want to plug, you have to go through me first. Anyway.
Yeah. And if you want my personal Instagram, it's that guy Rin on Instagram. That guy Rin.
And his other Instagram is at Kelly Prime.
And also online top shelf at Instagram and Instagram.
Okay. So right before we did.
Dude, I'm having fun, man.
Go ahead, man. Right before we did this podcast, Rin asked me, can he bring up a subject? Can he decide what topic do you want to talk about today? So he was wondering if you could ask me a few questions. I was like, go ahead, man. Go away. Ask a few questions. So at this moment, I would just like to bring up Rin, go ahead and ask a question away. What do you want to ask me that the audience haven't known yet?
Okay, so this is the Sopan Q&A. I think it's like the fourth or fifth episode. We're not really keeping count until he puts up the title.
Yeah.
But I just want to give it an opportunity for Sopan to share, you know, little stuff about himself. He's a talented guy. You know, he's over here. He set up all this stuff, and we're doing it. You know,
right.
Like not everyone said, "Bro, that's mine."
Is this yours, really?
No, I'm just saying, that's you.
Oh my God.
That's all you, bro. That's all you.
Oh wait, this one's right here.
Nah, that's all you.
That's all good.
That's all you. I don't drink.
All right, let's bring this one. All right, Rin, enough beating around the bushes and enough killing time. So, right. What kind of question do you have to ask me this time?
I got you, brother. So basically, man, what makes you so cool, man?
What made me so cool?
Yeah, it's I know it's a confident booster type of question, but I think you're a cool guy.
Okay.
Yeah, you know.
Okay,
what I mean?
I can't deny a compliment. You know, it's like if you want to compliment me, by all means. I mean, it's not an insult.
That's why he's so cool.
I don't know. I mean, what's your definition of cool?
Man, what makes you you? You know what I mean? Like, why? Like, you know, when they say, Sopan, do you? You know what I mean?
Okay.
What do you do to make you you?
I don't know. I just, I was born this way, I guess. I don't know. I mean, I'm just being myself. I mean, I'm living one day at a time.
100.
Try to chase, you know, make that dream happen like everyone else. I'm just a normal person like everyone else. Have a you know, opinion, have a idea, have a conscience, you know. I'm not any different from anyone else. Deep down inside I bleed like everyone else. So I'm just a regular person just doing my own thing.
He bleed from the heart for the ladies.
For the ladies. Right now I'm not focused on the ladies right now, right? My main focus is like try to better myself. That's what it is. This is what this podcast is all about. It's for people to better themselves, to learn more about themselves. That's what it is. I'm just here to give you guys help and encouragement to pursue what you want to pursue in life. So it's not all about me. This podcast is for everyone else. So if you guys are wondering, yeah, I mean, you know, there's too much things going on in this world. It's not enough time. There's no time for having an ego. That's my philosophy, man.
Yeah. So yeah, on that note, just because he brought it up, you know, like if you guys are talented or you guys trying to push something that you guys need you know, some exposure, you know what I mean? We're right here. We'll host something where we, you know, we'll ask you some questions the same way you're asking Sopan right now.
Right. If you guys have any, you know, requests for a topic, you know, just email us. You know, all the information is down in the description. I'll make sure to put that down there. So if you guys ever feel the need to need advice or something, just drop us a line. Just drop us a line and we'll try to accommodate you somehow.
Yeah. Okay, so on to the next question. So, Pon. Okay, man. So where do you see this going? This podcast.
This podcast? Okay.
Right. Highly evolved. You know? What do you
hopefully,
see? What's your goals? What's your
vision? I mean, it'll be weird if somebody say I want to see this podcast fail. I mean, obviously everybody wants their thing to succeed, right? Yeah. So obviously my goal for this podcast is to be more, you know, to be successful, you know, for more people to discover. To discover it, and I feel like that this podcast is I want this podcast to focus on subject that people rarely talk about. That's what it is, and just because that's the reason why people are so what word I'm trying to look for, so oblivious to what's going on. So I concocted this podcast to deliver information that people need to know. That's what it is. Basically, it's like a self-improvement podcast to help you guys out and to help everyone out in the world. So, I mean, that's what I want to do, just to help everybody out. It's not for fame or fortune. It's just to encourage people, to enlighten people.
In other words, if you listen to us, you'll feel better.
Right? I mean, it's all right. I mean, the podcast is going on a good start right now. I mean, we still do an episode. I mean, we don't stop. We just stop it. We just keep pushing to it. My thing is, like, if you have a dream, just chase it.
Don't
make any excuses. Yeah.
All right, so Pon.
Oh, wait, you asked me a question.
Huh?
Maybe I should ask you a question.
You think that was enough? That was enough.
I don't know, just keep asking your question.
All right, one more question, and then so Pon, if you want to know this guy, like, he calls himself a minimalist. Right, I think we kind of touched base a little bit last time.
Maybe we did touch.
But I want him to explain what that is because, for me, I feel like he's not a real one.
Not a real one. Okay. What minimalist is? Minimalist is based on the person definition. What it is, basically, the general idea of minimalist is that you focus on the thing that give value to your life. That's what it is. If it's something that doesn't serve you in your life. It shouldn't be in your life at all. So basically, just make everything that's involved with your life have values to it that you value. Because if you don't, it's gonna only my thing is if it doesn't give you value, it's gonna only hold you back. That's what it is. Minimalist doesn't necessarily mean that you have to limit everything out of your closet and just have only like 2-3 items at all. Minimalist mean that you only keep the stuff or try to gather the stuff that gives you value. You could be a minimalist and have like. You know, all furnace. If it makes you happy, if it gives you value in your life, by all means, keep it. That's what a minimalist to me. You know, it doesn't mean like it's the extreme minimalist. I mean, sure, I'm just yapping right now. I mean, I meet minimalists that just extremely minimalist. They only keep like 100 items in their household, and that's it. That's what it is. I mean, that's kind of
fundamental.
Yeah, that's a fundamental minimalist. But in my opinion, it's basically things that give you value. It's not because I don't want people to get the meaning of minimalist is basically you have to live with fewer things. That's not what minimalist is. You know, it's not live with the most fewest thing ever. It basically you live with something that makes you a better person.
So you prioritize what's important. You keep that.
Basically,
right?
Yeah. And you know, just
you guys.
If it's bad, if it's giving you bad vibe or anything, that's basically get rid of it. That's it. Because you don't want anything. To hold you back.
You guys should listen to this guy, man. He's passionate. Dude. Like, I swear he's like freaking missionary work on me.
Find your passion. That's
you know what I mean? Like he wants to convert me. But, you know.
I mean, I've been doing this for a while. You know, I've been
involved. Preaching.
No, not preaching.
Preaching,
you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, I just love to talk on the radio. I've been involved with the radio ever since I was in college. And I just feel like I need to get back on what my original passion was. So I feel like the podcast gave me a platform to pursue my dream, continue to pursue my dream. That's what it is. That's why I'm doing this thing for you guys.
So what if you know, 5 years from now, you know what I mean? Like you still got this little table, you got two little mics.
Hopefully you guys pass on the word, share, like, and subscribe.
Nothing's really advanced, you know what I mean? Your technology is still the same, you know. What then?
But then I just keep pushing. Never quit.
Never quit.
That's
right.
What it is.
Minimalist.
Never give up.
Minimalist.
Minimalist, that's right. If you find enjoyment, because I know people do podcasts without nothing and they still enjoy the fact of doing it.
Okay.
Yeah.
I ain't like that though, man. I'm with him, man. We can go to the top. All right. I'm that guy, Ren.
There's no room for the bottom.
I'm that guy, Ren. We're going up.
All right, Ren. I guess we just turned the table around.
All right.
What's your philosophy about life?
My philosophy about life?
Yeah, how do you live day by day?
Man, you know, I live by the golden rule, you know what I mean? I try to treat people right, mm-hmm. but you know, sometimes I'm not the best at it, but I don't do any, I try not to do no wrong, you know what I mean? Like, so, I try not to hurt people, you know what I mean? Emotionally and physically, that's not me. And then, you know, I believe in karma, you know what I mean? Like, you know, if I do something bad, you know, I'll expect something bad to happen, you know, time later, you know?
I can respect that. I think I share the same kind of belief because if you do something bad to people, it's going to come around and bite you in the ass. And that's what I think, you know. People do not deserve to be treated badly, you know. I mean, if you have a bad day, okay, you have a bad day, but you have to look at the bright side. That it's only one day. The next morning is a new day. That's what it is. You gotta live the day by day. You know,
yeah.
Anything that's happened and yesterday, just leave it behind. I mean, some stuff can affect you in the future, but yet again, you have to think positive and just let life lead you. You know, that's what it is. That's what it is to me.
It's like counseling over here, man. It's like counseling. He's giving me.
Oh, you took 1 year psych class. So. I'm not expert because I'm not saying this.
Yeah.
But what's going on in the news lately? What's going on in your mind lately? What have you been doing?
In my mind?
Have you read any good articles or anything that struck you?
I just keep myself occupied. You know, I'm just working on my businesses.
Mm-hmm.
Everything exciting happening. And I just keep it moving, man. Just flowing.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? As far as the news goes, you know, I stay away from the political stuff. You know, I've seen how horrible, you know, all that, you know, presidential campaign happened, you know.
Yeah.
And, you know, how it gets to people, right?
Right.
Don't want that, you know. Like negativity most of the time, you know what I mean? People talk political, but it's normally just turn out negative.
Yeah, I mean, to me, I think if they want to pop, because this is what I see in the news. This is what's on my mind. I mean, people want to get political, but yet again, they don't know both sides of the story. They want to jump to conclusion and not understand the situation before even making a opinion about a certain thing. That's what I think. My thing is, I mean, you got to hear from both sides of the story before you make an assumption about how things are going, you know? That's like listening to one side of the argument and just only take one side without hearing the other person's side. That's like, to me, that's irrational thinking in a way. Because if you're gonna do that, that's gonna it tells you what type of person you are in life. That's what it is. You don't want to be that person, you know. You want to be a smart, intellect person, but yet again, you have the capability to think rationally and to think critically before jumping to conclusion. That's what I think. That's what I believe. But in my opinion, what's going on in my mind is that I mean, from where we are right now, I think things are not, oh my God, things are not looking good to me for some reason, you know? Because, you know, after living, we're living in California right now, okay? California is going through so many issues right now. You know, there's, oh my God. There's so many issues right now, especially in Long Beach. Things have changed a lot. Would you agree with that, man?
Yeah, man. We got the new Long Beach, what you call it, letter Long Beach, you know, what we call this?
Yeah.
Long Beach Post, Business Journal, right? Mm-hmm. They have like these cranes, and I guess they're building like towers and stuff. So it's really up to date with Long Beach because it's changing a lot. Like I talk to customers every day since I'm a barbershop owner and I get a lot of clients and stuff. And they're always talking about, you know, hey, I just moved in from this and that place, or, you know what I mean? I've only been in for 2 weeks, and there's a lot of changes, and people like it. You know what I mean? They like it.
I mean, would you say what kind of changes? Like positive changes or negative changes?
Yeah, well, okay, you know, like the concept of gentrification, you know what that is?
Yeah, it's
you know.
Yeah, we know gentrification.
Kicking out the old,
bringing
you know,
the new. Yeah, again, the new, yeah. When you do that, I think when you do that, it's. It's there's a good side and a bad side to it. The good side is that it's bringing more revenues into the city. It's right. changing the city. And the bad side is that it's, to me, what I think is the bad side is that it's eliminating the culture of the city. That's what it is. It's pushing some people away from certain kind of, I don't want to say neighborhood, communities. You know what I'm saying?
Right. So the bad thing about gentrification is, you know, you have like residents that's been here for 20, 30 plus years, and you know, like, and like obviously the city, the officials and whatnot, and they have their plans to renew, right? Mm-hmm. To build new things, and you know, they're basically just gonna take over, you know what I mean, kick everybody out, you know. Is that right?
It's okay, out with no oversight. I think that's, you know, we're not considering the people in the community that.
Well, you know what I mean, with pictures like these, you know, like obviously there's gonna be some gentrification going on. You know what I mean?
To me,
like,
this picture right here, to me, it's just the top of the thing, the top of the iceberg. It's not really showing the underneath of it.
Yeah.
It's not telling. It's just one. It's telling. I don't know. Just put it down. It's not. It's not okay. It just, I don't say it's a front. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But there's two, like I said before, there's two sides of the stories. You know?
Yeah.
There's two sides of the stories. Sometimes it's kind of biased when it just only focuses on positive and not reflect on the negative.
Yeah, yeah. You
know? It's kind of biased.
That's the wrong part about it.
Yeah,
right?
That's when they do just putting out the city is progressing, but yet again, or they can talk about the negative consequences.
Right. You know? How are they gonna?
Cater to other problems in the city?
How are they? Because they want something new to build to come up. Right. How are they gonna take care of the people that's gonna be affected by it?
Yeah. For me, the single most problem right now in Long Beach is I would have to say is homelessness. You know what I'm saying? From my point of view, I think the city should spent their budget on something that would help the situation more on homelessness than it is to increase revenue.
Yeah.
You know, because right now homelessness is a really big problem right now. I mean, from 10 years ago, I mean, I'm sure you would agree to this too. From 10 years ago, homelessness wasn't this bad in Long Beach. You know?
I believe it.
You know, it wasn't, I mean, every time I'm driving, and another thing that's affecting the city is traffic.
Yeah.
Traffic is really a problem. I mean, that's a good thing because it's bringing revenue, but yet again, it's creating havoc, you know, among the community. There's a lot of cars in the traffic, more pollution, more people are angry, you know, but that's besides the point. Let me go back to the original topic of homelessness. I mean, 10 years ago, it wasn't to this point where I see people walking left and right, all homeless. You know, 10 years ago, it was only like once every often you see a homeless person, right? Once every often. You see a homeless person, but right now I'm seeing like it's become a normal thing now. There's homeless. There's people living in RVs now. There's more people living in the cars than there are a few years ago. That's really. I mean, homelessness. Just don't let this issue affect people. That's what it is. You know.
Right, but you think. You know, the homelessness is because of the gentrification, because of
building up of the towns. No, I think it's more dynamic than that. Homeless is more dynamic than that. Instead of they should be focused on jobs, okay? On jobs, basically, that's what it is. I mean,
right.
Entitlement, I mean, that's another different issue.
You're building up these things so that
these buildings.
People can have jobs.
But right? Yet again, it's jobs for, okay, when you look at these buildings, it's not necessarily catered to the average Joe to work in. These office buildings are usually catered to people who's like already established and stuff, you know? People
right.
who got been, for the regular Joe who doesn't have a high school diploma, education, or anything, these buildings doesn't help them as much. I mean, sure, they provide jobs, but it's gonna be one of those low wage jobs in these buildings. Like janitor, janitorial, and, you know, all these things, but. They're not looking at a bigger picture. I mean, are these jobs going to provide job for everyone or just only a job for certain people that favor their interests? That's how I believe. I mean, that's what I think, but I'm not necessarily that I'm right or not. you know. But I'm just only saying what I'm seeing with my eyes right now.
Right.
You know. But how do you feel about this, man?
Homeless people in Long Beach. You know,
I'm sorry to touch on the subject, but I mean, this is one issue that really bothers me. I mean, I don't want to see people homeless. I want to see people prosperous.
Right.
You know, I do not, because when people are homeless, they're affecting everybody else. If people are prosperous, they're doing their own thing and they're not trying to affect no one else.
Okay, so what do you do when you see a homeless man? Do you contribute? Do you give him money? Do you offer him food?
Are
you going to offer him a place to stay?
No.
You know what I mean? How do you fix him? You know, sometimes it's a psychology too,
yes,
right?
Yes, it's a psychology. This is why I heard about homeless people. Some people choose to live like that. Okay? Some people, they force themselves in that position, right? But there are some people who's less fortunate that can't help it. They fell into the crack and couldn't get out. You know?
Right.
I don't have a single answer for this, because there's multiple answers for this, you know?
Right.
I can't just say, oh, they should do this or move a job. That doesn't necessarily help the situation out. I mean, there's a lot of things that people can do to help the situation out. I mean, sure, I mean, I don't want people to get harassed by cops or anything, or make new legislative or city ordinance that people can't do anything. There should be more, I think, I don't want to say it because I won't have the answer to this. That's what I'm saying. I won't have the answer to this because I'm not a politician. I can't have solutions. But there are, I think the politicians who say they have to answer it aren't executing it well.
You know, I've always been kind of not really impressed with how you know, some homeless programs are, you know what I mean?
Right, like
they have these big old shelters, right? And they're just supposed to give these guys a place to stay, or, you know, families a place to stay until they get back on their feet, right? But, like, it's really hard.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like,
I don't want
to. It's like you're saying, hey, look, man, we're the system that can't support you because you don't want to be supported, but then we're the system that's trying to bring you back.
Right.
You know what I mean?
They say we don't want to give you entitlement, yet again, we're not offering you the opportunity to get off your feet. You know what I'm saying?
But then we try to, you don't want it.
Yeah,
you
know, people don't want it, but I don't know. It's a very...
It's like a catch-22 or something.
It's a very dynamic issue, but that's one of the issues that's on my radar right now, is homelessness and loneliness.
Yeah, how would you fix it, though, as far as...
I'm just curious if I would fix it.
From creativity.
I think the leader should allocate a certain kind of funds to establish temporary housing. No, because we don't... Okay, I think Long Beach, I'm not sure I'm not right or not, right? Because I haven't seen it. I don't think Long Beach have some kind of temporary housing right now, you know? And if they do have
temporary... You talking about a shelter or a housing?
Shelter. But if they do, because what they're doing right now is, you know, they don't want, you know, there's this revolution going on about tiny houses, right? You know,
yeah,
you hear about that, right?
Yeah, the little
houses.
That's been put on the sidewalks.
Right. I mean, I see small houses. I mean, I'll allocate in certain spaces that allow homeless to live in these tiny houses until they get back on their feet.
Just so they can stay out the rain.
Yeah, just to stay out of the rain, give them a mailing address. Because that's what prevents people from having a job. Because they don't have no places to...
Right.
Save himself, you know. If they have a mailing address, they could apply themselves. That's what I'm saying. Allocate certain spaces that people live in these houses for a certain period of time, a temporary basis, until they get off their feet. And once they get off their feet, they could transition themselves into.
I'm gonna give you some more to think about. I'm gonna add on to what you were saying.
Okay.
Right? I like the idea of like little small tiny houses, right?
Right. But the city don't want that. That's the thing.
Right. If I was a city official, this is how I would go about it, right?
Right.
Tiny houses, right? Give them a little community, gated community. You know, put them all in there. You know, have them clean themselves up, but. There's always a but, right? Because like, you can't just give something for nothing. You know what I mean?
Right.
So it wouldn't make no sense for you to give a man a shelter and a mailing address so he can have opportunities and not charge him for it. Right.
I mean, not charge him for it.
Yeah, it wouldn't make no sense, right?
Yeah.
He doesn't have to pay in money.
Right.
paying work. You know, what I mean,
like,
look, hey,
community service.
Guess what? You gotta keep this area clean, or you know, you have to do this, you have to do that. You have to contribute back to society in a way where, you know, I mean, 3 or 4 hours a day, and the rest of the time, hey, guess what? You had to go out there and look for work.
Right, exactly.
You know what I mean? That's the best way to put them back on their feet fast.
I don't want to say giving stuff, because giving people stuff is the wrong total intention.
Right.
Because it's not helping them. It's just enabling them to do to fall in the same footstep that they're doing right now. It's just keep giving stuff. I think we should, like, you know, like, I don't say ultimatum, but I think that's the word, ultimatum, right?
It's an exchange.
It's an exchange. Like, all right, a certain period of time, you have to work.
Get to work for the city. You have to pay your taxes. That's what it is. You know,
like, help with the community. Don't just.
And then at the same time, you know what? Guess who's the onlooker, right? The people, the regular citizens that are just watching. Hey, look, man, this guy is really doing his right. best.
In
you
that
know
case,
what I mean?
We don't have to worry about. That's the one thing that would save the city a lot of money.
Yeah, because you
providing free housing in exchange for work.
In exchange for work, exactly.
Yeah. And then while you're doing that work, and in the meantime, you're still looking for work.
Real work. You
that
know?
Might be one solution, you know?
Yeah.
That's one solution. But we're not politicians. Nah, we're just giving out ideas.
Nah, we just lonely YouTube podcasters.
Entrepreneurs. Contractors. But anyway.
For sale.
All right. But that's one thing that's reflecting upon. That I want to reflect on. Is there a certain issue that's on your mind right now?
Nah, man. Not that I can think of, man. Online dating is a hot topic, though, man.
I talk about
almost every day over here.
I heard one thing about online dating that, you know, the Tinder, right?
Yeah.
Okay, I heard that it's really not equal for men. Compared to
equal,
women. Yeah.
As far as, you know, how many
like
exchange of information,
right?
Exchange of
right. Like women, I don't want to. This is a certain topic, all right. This might be a certain. I don't want to say it.
He always
okay,
sexist when it comes to women
this
and men.
Heard. It's not for me. That's what I heard. It's like women are in Tinder that women are being so selective of what they are instead
right.
of accepting the guy for what he is and work around it. Instead, you know, they're really. You know,
shallow. You ladies.
At the point
you
where
you ladies are shallow. You know what I mean? I'm over here working hard on my Tinder, my profile up to date.
I'm sorry, ladies. All right, but if you're in a position of actually going offline dating, I think you don't have the position to be picky. You know.
Dang.
because if you find yourself in a dating program like that, obviously you really want somebody in your life. I mean, you really have to. So my thing is, there's no actually Mr. Right. There's no Mr. Perfect in this world.
Give okay? Sopon some action, yo.
There's no kind of Mr. Perfect in the world. There's Mr. Okay, but you have to work around him. That's what it is.
Yeah.
You have to work around with what you got, because if you don't. If you don't, age will catch up with you, and it's gonna be far harder for you to find somebody else. You know,
yeah.
It's very difficult, especially for men right now. Well, men and women.
Okay.
Let's say that, especially with women when they hit a certain age, it's harder for them to find certain people because they're not. Have you heard about this thing called sexual market value?
Sexual market value.
Right.
You on different websites, man. I'm just on regular Facebook, Instagram, Twitter.
I don't have Facebook, by the way.
He's on sexual intimate market, whatever
okay,
you call
sexual
it.
Value, sexual market value means that a gender has a certain amount of years before their expiration of appeal expired. You know what I'm trying to say?
Have you ever seen a hot, older woman with kids?
Have I seen it? Very few.
Man.
That's it. Very few. It's not a lot.
I see it all the time.
That's not a lot. You see it all the time. Obviously, we're not hanging in the wrong place, right places. Obviously, we're not hanging together here that often. But that's the thing with sexual market value. You gotta know your sexual market value because, you know, I mean, if you're like a 5, you can't expect to see yourself with a 10. You understand? You know, can you... I mean, do you understand? I mean,
yeah, I get it. Like, you know,
I mean, you have to be realistic. You know,
that's why
I want to revert back to. You can't be picky that much because there's no Mr. Right. Yeah, there's have to be some compromises. you know?
You want to sing real quick? I have to go get something.
Okay, we're back. Rin had to do something, but we left off on sexual market value. Basically, I was explaining to Rin sexual market value is basically how is your sex appeal
hello.
To people. That's what sexual market value is, and you have to identify what it is. You know, you have to know what's your sexual market value. So you gotta be realistic, and you can't be kind of picky on who you dated. You know, sure you can be a little bit picky, but yet again, you gotta be realistic on what person, how the person is, because there are no Mr. Right and there are no Mr. Wrong. You know, that's my that's my opinion on that subject.
So, when you're swiping left or right? Right is usually the you like them, right?
Left
is usually you don't like them. But when you're swiping right, you see a hot girl and you swipe right. You don't read in the information. I know the guys don't really read the information.
To be honest, I never used Tinder. I haven't used Tinder yet.
Yeah. You swipe, you know what I mean? And then what he's saying is then when you see like an average looking girl or a girl that's not, you know, like really that attractive or like...
It's very subjective. That's what it is.
Right. But when you say attractive, right, you're saying like this girl doesn't have the model look. You know what I mean? The look that you see on TVs and magazine, right? So you don't swipe right.
Because they're not... Okay, in TV and magazine, they're not perceive what they want...
I mean, even when you're seeing like a real photo of a girl, right? Mm-hmm. What do you want to see? You don't want to, you know what I mean? Like, what do you want to see?
From my point of view?
Yeah. As far as sexual market value,
some
right?
Kind of, you know, some kind of, you know, youthfulness, some kind of beauty, and you know.
Right, but like, everyone nowadays has a 4K.
We're not expecting for a girl to have a tattoo on her forehead. Expected this.
No. I'm just saying. Everyone right now they have a three high definition camera that will take pictures high definition. You know what I mean? You can see all the flaws, right?
Yeah.
And you can even tweak it, right?
Yeah.
And so as far as like skin feature and stuff, you can't really see the real, you know?
Yeah, I mean, it's doctored.
But what kind of stuff don't you want to see from a girl?
Want to see from a girl?
Yeah.
Like boogers hanging out of her nose.
Dang, okay.
A mole with hair growing out of it.
right. Hopefully that don't happen.
Hopefully you have better standards than that.
That's... In Topan's definition, that's low market value.
That's low market value, I guess. I mean, I don't be so picky or superficial, but that's yet again, these are the person you have to look at. Because you're trying to find a mate.
And then, so, when I'm swiping right,
mm-hmm.
I look, man, if someone smiles good, and then I feel like, man, that's a good smile, I would like to see that in real life.
Right.
You know what I mean?
But the thing is, when you do initiate a date, will the person reciprocate the same kind of emotion that you will? You know what I'm saying?
Will they meet me halfway?
That's unknown. That's the unknownness of it.
Right, but then at that point, you know, you have to pay for Tinder service so you can get the feature.
You pay for it?
I mean, there's features that, you know, that unlocks, you know, like your opportunities to meet them a lot better.
I didn't know that.
That's why you ain't got no dates, bro.
I'm fine. I'm content where I'm at right now.
You gotta pay to play. Pay to play, bro.
Yeah, pay to play. Oh my God.
Tinder's motto, pay to play.
On that note, I think this topic could go in a little bit deeper, but I don't want to focus in on just Tinder.
Another one. We're talking about the extra of Tinders.
Extra of Tinders, all right. There's plenty of fish, but I heard that was too. But all right. On another note, the thing what's wrong with Obamacare is not just a penalty. Okay.
Yeah.
Imagine if you qualify for Obamacare, the premium is more than that. The premium of Obamacare is even more than most insurance.
Exactly. It's right.
Even more than most insurance. So if it's not the case, you might as well go apply for a private insurance company.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So what's the purpose? I mean, if it's that much, it's not affordable. Right? Would you agree? It's not affordable if it's more than the.
Okay, when they say it's Affordable Care Act or whatever you call it, right? What are you affording? Are you affording like maybe at some point you have the craziest illness ever where like, right. Hey, look, I'm going to go in because ain't no other doctors can get me, but I got a Obamacare, I'm good. You know what I mean?
No,
like,
really
so, but every time before then, before you got this crazy illness, like, what, is the government expecting you to become super sick one day or something? Like, yeah, you know what I mean? So you gotta pay beforehand before you get to the point where, like, you're on your deathbed, and then they'll take care of you.
That's dumb. Yeah, that's what I'm getting is that I guess they do a physical on you, right? If you do a physical on you, and they say you're in perfect health, right?
Right.
Then why are the premiums still the same? I mean, shouldn't people in perfect health get a discount on, compared to people who's in poor health? Would you agree with that? Is that fair? No? It's basically, it's compared to a driver's license, right? I mean, not driver's insurance, right? That's like charging the same premium for a reckless driver than it is charging the same premium for a cautious driver. You know what I'm saying? So, like, you're a safe driver.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But you're being charged as a reckless driver. I don't think that's fair. You're not,
that's not fair. That's not fair. Yeah, that's not fair.
It's not fair because, you know, some people are law-abiding citizens. They've been buying the law
for a long time, right?
A long time.
You should be rewarded for it, but not
rewarded. Not even saying rewarded, but just to be fair. But again, to be fair, I mean, it's being punished because they're not neglecting the system, you know?
Yeah.
And then the people that are neglecting the system, they're getting away with it.
Yeah.
But,
yeah,
it's a very big issue. That's the thing with Obamacare to me. Not just that Obamacare, but really health in general is a very big issue to me. I just spit on the table, I'm sorry. But it's not just that, it's just health in general. Health is a very important issue when it comes to living, being a human being, you know? Health, to me, health is the number one concern, because without health, you really got no cause of fighting for anyway. That's what people don't get. These people are protesting things that they don't have no idea about the issue at all. Because, I mean, I've been watching this, have you been watching, I don't know what to say, Riley Factor. But there's this guy on the Riley Factor named Jesse Waters, right? He's going around asking people about certain situations, and some of these people don't know what are they protesting about.
Yeah.
Some of these people are just there because the people are there. You know?
Yeah.
It just doesn't make any sense. But back to what I was saying is to be aware of what you think. I mean, to me right now, one of the biggest issues that is affecting me is, have you heard about the Fukushima radio?
We talked about last week.
Okay, I want to expand on that, right?
All right.
I want to expand that because right now...
Man, we talked about it last week.
Don't do that, all right? This is really important to me, okay? 6 years! That's just the sorry. But 6 years ago, you know, the earthquake happened, right? Uh-huh. But now there's a report saying the radiation is leaching onto California coast. You know, it's leaching to California coast, and I don't know. Food, so I just at that point I just had it because I just stopped eating seafood basically, because the radiation, I've gotten that bad right now. You know, imagine if. Right now, I would not suggest anybody go swimming in the Pacific Ocean right now. You know?
Yeah.
It's really that bad. Because there's been an example that there's fish that's been washing up on California shores that shouldn't be washing up. There's like dead sea life. I mean, if that's not convincing enough for you that the Pacific Ocean is dying, I don't know what will. You know? I mean, do you have to see a more devastation before people really comprehend what the situation is right now? Oh my god. In California, how do you feel about the situation in California right now?
As far as what, weather, economy?
General.
The way it
like
is.
Policy, legislative, economy?
I'm not really a political guy, bro. Like,
right now, California is in S-hole right now. S-H-I-T hole.
Uh-huh.
Right now, because the legislative are really, they're applying legislative that doesn't make any sense. You know, the businesses, California is the least business friendly state in the whole union right now, right?
Right.
Would you agree? They say people are flocking away in droves, like by millions right now. There's they're moving to Nevada, Arizona, Texas, especially Texas right now. Texas seem appealing. Texas is like, all these states that they're moving to are really business friendly. That's what it is.
Yeah, Texas is hot. We know that already.
It's really easy, especially when you're an entrepreneur, like I guess we are, right?
Would you move to Texas?
Would I move to Texas? I'm seriously considering about it.
Yeah.
You know, I'm seriously considering about it, but I have a lot of family here, but the thing is right now, the way that California is going right now.
You might be the first one, man. You
the know way I mean? California is going right now is really detrimental right now. It's really dire straight right now in California. Population growth are increased. Traffic is bad, right? Traffic is bad. The open border issue, right? Prices are expensive. You know, California housing are more expensive than any housing in another union.
California housing?
Yeah. That's the thing.
Okay.
It's really expensive to live in California as of the moment right now. You know? But I guess right now we gotta... I'm living day by day, one day at a time, looking at the bright side. But I mean, I just hope California does. I hope California make the right choices and not and go on the right track instead of going the wrong path. That's what you hope. I really hope for the state to turn around.
Yeah.
You know.
I really wish it too, man. You know what I mean? For your sake, bro.
Right. This is. I just want to look out for everybody. People don't see that. But, oh my god. But that's what's. The type of story that's really affecting me right now. I've been reading up on what else I've been reading up. Oh, a really big story came out. Vote 19. I mean, vote 7. Have you heard about that?
No. What is that about? What is that about?
Vote 7.
What's going on there?
Vote 7 is basically a document leaked by WikiLeaks that indicate that the CIA is actually spying on you. For example, you know Samsung TV, right?
Uh-huh.
In vote 7, indicate that the CIA are capable of hacking to your Samsung TV, the smart TV, right? Make believe that when you shut it off, that you think you shut it off, but in actuality,
the camera's
still on and still recording you. The thing is, I don't know what are they doing with this information, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, for me, I'm considering myself not a threat, but I don't know why would they need my information for. It's a privacy issue. That's why people are so up in arms right now. It's basically a privacy issue, but how do you feel about the government spying on you?
They're not spying on me. I mean, everyone is a business entity into itself. Everyone has mm-hmm. has proprietary dues
mm-hmm.
to give some contributions back to the government, right?
Right,
because
right.
You're living on their soil.
This is a, right? It's a great area to this.
I'm not saying that... That, you know, like, I mean, you know, the government, right? This land is free for everybody,
mm-hmm.
but you're using the government's services and stuff so you can be generally, you know what I mean, like, supported and comforted and feel protected and have a sense of security, right? That's what, you know.
That's what the government's supposed to provide.
Yeah.
To secure.
It's security, you know what I mean? It's justice or whatever, right? When something goes wrong, you know, yeah, that's those instances when something goes wrong. Well, yep. Most of the time, 80, you know, maybe 70, 80, you know, higher up than 50s percentage that you know, most people are generally doing, you know,
mm-hmm.
okay. You know what I mean? They have a place to live, you know, and the government do right for them.
Distinguish how do you distinguish when it's going too far? Yeah.
When
your civil liberty been violated. You know, that's a gray area that people don't talk about, you know. You know, sure they're there to protect you, you know, but there's a sacrifice that comes with it.
No. Yeah, so
you know, it's like your freedom. You want that protection, but yet again, it's your
yeah.
Privacy.
You want that freedom, right? You don't want to be you don't want to be spied upon. You don't want to be kept on
taking naked pictures.
You know what I mean?
Have you seen them?
Tapped.
Have you seen?
You know what I mean? Like tapped.
Yeah, wiretap.
Yeah, tapped.
Yeah. Have you seen the movie Snowden?
I seen halfway.
Crazy movie. I think that's they touch on that subject a little bit.
Yeah,
you know where Edward Snowden was like in the CIA in Hawaii,
yeah.
And he showed him how the dude showed him how they,
yeah,
how they spy on the people with their computer cameras.
Yeah,
you know they just type it out and they just find it like that. It was so effortless the way they do it. I was like, what?
Yeah,
they actually do this, but oh my god.
Oh, that stuff is real, man. there's a way to put it up there. That's a way to take it down. You know what I mean?
Oh my god! All right. But us being an entrepreneur, I show you this book, right? If you guys are wondering, I just bought this book by Tony Robbins, his new book. It's called Unshakable, right? Basically, in this book, it just tells you, he tells you what to do to put you on the safe side, like how to invest the right way instead of the wrong way. Instead of like, you know, when people buy stock, right? He said there's a wrong way of doing it because the way people been doing it is like they're getting taxed on their stock when they shouldn't be having it, like fees, all these unnecessary fees. So basically this book just tells you that people need to be aware of what's the right way to invest your money instead of the wrong way to invest your money, you know? So basically in this book, basically you go around and ask 50 of the most elite people, richest people, and ask them what's their secret to success. And he just lay them out on this book called Unshakable. Right now I'm reading through the book right now. It's really intriguing right now. So right now I'm really, the idea of compound interest is really appealing right now. So right now I want to invest in compound interest. Yet again, I don't know where to start to get that right now. But as soon as I read up on the book, I'll fill you guys up on it. But it's really interesting. But on that note, us being an entrepreneur ourselves, I told Rin the other day that I watched this movie, The Founder, right? About Ray Kroc and McDonald's. And how you feel? You said you've seen that movie, right?
Yeah.
What's your opinion of that movie?
I thought Ray Kroc was a genius. I thought he was able to, the movie made him out to be like a sincere guy, but you know, like,
underlying meaning to it.
Yeah,
too.
It's underlying.
You don't know how he's really like.
Yeah, we don't know what he's really like, you know, but the way the story is told, like, you know, those guys weren't doing right by the name McDonald's, so yeah. Ray Kroc had to take it and gave the U.S., you know, this piece of valuable. That's cake, you know what I mean?
In that movie, I think one smart thing, the solution, in the movie, Ray Kroc, they were saying that he wasn't making a profit, right? He wasn't making a profit because he was only franchising, right?
Right.
He was only franchising, and then he met this guy to tell him, what if you, instead of franchising, become a real estate owner?
Okay.
You know? So he convinced Ray Kroc to buy land, and then the people who franchises McDonald's pay him because the majority of the money that he made came from real estate.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And then it's a 20 year lease on that land. So that's how Ray Kroc became what he is, because he found another way of doing things instead of, he just found other ways of doing things. I think that's what.
Well, McDonald's is still a gem, right?
McDonald's still a conglomerate. And
So McDonald's was the thing that the American people believed in. Being a real estate owner was a way for Ray Kroc to undercut the McDonald brothers.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like,
right. So, when you watch the movie, it's really shady what he did, right? It's really shady what he did because the McDonald brothers, they have value, right?
Yeah.
They have values because they don't want to change anything. All their menu was really cheap, and not cheap, but they want quality into it. But Ray Kroc find another way to, because Ray Kroc in his mindset is all about profiting. Right?
Yeah.
But I can't blame him because he was in a situation where he needed the money because he had to survive, right?
Yeah.
He had to survive as well. So it's really how you look at it. You can either look at him as a genius or look at him as a predator on the McDonald brothers. Because when it comes to McDonald brothers, they're really emphasizing quality, you know? They want fast service, but yet again, the food quality. And this, for example, I don't want spoiler alert, right? Spoiler for you guys. But in this one scene that he wanted to replace the ice cream with powdered ice cream because it would save the company more money, right? That the McDonald brothers are really apprehensive about it because they're really concerned about the quality of it, you know? But it's really how you look at it, you know? It reflects on today's philosophy too. I mean, for example, look at In-N-Out, right? They kept their menu and quality food the way it is since the first day they opened. So they're doing good right now, and McDonald's doing bad right now. You know, so it's really a matter of how you look at things. You know, business ethics.
Can't say that McDonald's is all over the world.
And yeah.
In-N-Out is not. You know what I mean?
Okay, I understand that. But the reason why, I guess, and it's my opinion. It's my opinion. But the reason I think that In-N-Out don't want to do that is because they wanna have kind of a quality to it. you know?
You can say that. I mean, but...
They want an oversight. Because McDonald, when she... Because they explained this in the movie, too. Remember? Because they don't... The reason why the McDonald brother didn't want to expand because it's harder to have oversight on all the stores.
Right, but the... Yeah, see...
And they did explain it, too, in the movie. They did show it that Ray Kroc effed up because he didn't oversight the store because some McDonald's back in the 50s were selling chicken and stuff, right?
Right, right.
And then he was mad about it because they're not following the franchise rules that they have to sell only these kind of items.
Right, right, right.
So that's where the idea of oversight plays in, I think.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, there's rules and regulations, you know, like you sign contracts to continue on what the franchise was meant to do, right? Which is to give the expansion the right service and products or whatever, right? So I mean, even if they took it and they decided, well, you know, we're not going to stick by the rules, you know, you get penalized for it,
right?
So that you can't keep the franchise if you're not going to follow by the rule,
right?
So you know what I mean, like, the brothers have the protection through the contract, so like they shouldn't have any issues. But the only issue with the brothers is they didn't know how to grow it. You know,
yeah,
what I mean?
Yeah,
grow.
That's why Ray Kroc found a loophole.
It's not a loophole. Ray Kroc had a majority, you know, of the franchise owners on his side.
Yeah, he got the franchise.
Everything's on his side. You know,
yeah, everything's on his side. But again, in the culture, you explain that
those guys like really was just. They're stuck on two shops,
yeah,
and they can barely run. You know what I mean?
So,
at the end of the day, they were no good for McDonald's. Then Ray Kroc is for McDonald's.
The reason why I say he found a loophole is because he found a loophole to bypass their oversight. Because
they said
their control is only when it's in the shop.
His entitlement to that
whatever that, outside the shop
that franchise. His entitlement of the ownership. Right?
Right,
was pretty much it showed, you know, how he was entitled to do whatever that he wanted to do.
Right,
he's entitled to give that movie, you know, that sense of like, dang, Ray Kroc is the man. You know what I mean?
Right.
Or Ray Kroc is the most coolest guy ever. Mm-hmm. Which, you know, he might not been.
Yeah,
but
we don't know him personally.
The movie's not gonna show that.
There's always gonna be a bias in the movie.
The movie's not gonna show that. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Obviously, yeah.
Ray Kroc was a great guy because he left a legacy for millions and millions of people that are working for the McDonald's Corporation now. That's what it is.
You know
what
I mean? Have you been to the original McDonald's?
I haven't. There's one in Downey. I mean,
that's the oldest. I think that's the oldest McDonald's. But I'm talking about the first McDonald's by the way.
Have you?
No, but I'm having the interest of my going visit because we're over there right now. At the original spot is a museum for the original McDonald's.
Oh, for real?
Yeah, it's actually a museum.
No.
It's free.
It's San Bernardino, right?
San Bernardino, California.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like a few hours from where we are.
That's not too bad.
It's
we should drive
bad.
Out, man.
So we can vacation. It's not like not vacation. We can trip.
We can drive out there, man. You know, we can invite all you friends that want to come join us.
We'll do a on location podcast.
Yeah, yeah.
If you get a chance. But at that moment, I think we have talked enough. Do you think?
Yeah, man, I'm tired of you.
All right, I think we should wrap it up right now. Once again, thanks for listening to us rambling. Thanks if you survived through the 1 hour podcast.
We really don't give you no less.
You know?
It's always 1 hour.
If you sit through an hour, at least you can do is just share and like our podcast.
Highly evolved.
Highly evolved. And as for right now, we just want to thank you guys and. Close it off right now. Ren, would you say goodbye?
My name is Ren, that guy Ren on Instagram. Follow me.
Alright, mine is Holly Evolve 1. Check me out and ask a moment. As always, thank you for watching and have a good day.
Peace.
Peace.
We did that, bro. We did that.
That's our podcast.